Live from the forest moon of Endor, Radio Free Endor, a Star Wars podcast, bringing you news and reviews from the galaxies far, far away.
Welcome to this very special showcase episode of Radio Free Endor. And today we are talking to Jason W. Christman. Hi, Jason. How are you doing?
Hello. I'm great. How are you doing?
Absolutely fantastic. Now, it's only been a couple of days since we last chatted because you came on the show. But now you've got some fantastic news. And, if you're on YouTube, you'll have a little spoiler because of the little picture, but I wanted to see it come from Jason's mouth himself. Jason, what's the good news?
I made it into the art show again for Celebration.
Yes, for the sixth time. Oh, fantastic! Yeah, if anyone's interested, if you go to Jason's website, you can actually see all his prints and the dude say that which celebrations was. So I should just click onto your website just to show people who are on YouTube. But let's go. Boop, there we go. This is your piece. Fantastic. Now this piece is called "We Have a Visitor." Is it called?
Yeah.
So, Jason, talk us through it. Talk us through this this fantastic piece.
Well, I mean, I was inspired by this desk piece I have sitting on my desk.
Yeah.
And, you know, Empire Strikes Back is, you know, 9 out of 10 Star Wars fans, it's their favorite, you know, especially the original trilogy. But for most fans, Empire Strikes Back is like, you know, the perfect movie for Star Wars fans. And,
yes,
you know, this probe droid dominated the opening scene of the movie. And, you know, it's just a very menacing droid. You know what I mean? It's so evil. I mean, it looks evil, it comes from evil, it sounds evil, even its low vibrating humming sound, its communication that C-3PO can't understand. It's even Han Solo said in the movie, he's all, it ain't friendly, whatever it is. Even yes, he did, without even looking at it, just from the sound of it, that it was not good. I'm a huge droid fan, as you know. You know, I built an R2 unit recently, you know, droids are just as big of characters in the movie as people are and as ships. So blue being my favorite color, I just thought, let's throw something together, you know, on Hoth with a probe droid and see where it goes. This was actually my second submission for this year. Every artist gets to submit two proof of concepts.
Yeah.
And the first one I spent months working on, which was an ode to Return of the Jedi's 40th reunion. It was Emperor Palpatine on his throne with his big Death Star window behind him, with Endor in the background. It was a beautiful piece. And then the last minute of the last day, I decided, you know, I should submit a second one. We can. Yeah. I might as well do it. And that's the one that got selected.
Yeah.
So I spent, you know, very little time on, at least on the concept. I spent a lot of time after it got approved to build it out properly. But yeah.
Is that the way the process usually works out, that you submit like two, or can you submit as many as you want for them
two,
to pick?
Two max.
Yeah.
Two at the most. In the past, I only submitted one. I was so sure of the print that I submitted that it would make it in. I did not make it in 2020 celebration, which didn't end up actually happen because of the pandemic. And that was the first time I didn't get selected, and I'd only submitted one print, and I said, I'm not doing that again. I got to submit at least two. I was too sure of myself and too cocky. I got too cocky, kid. and it bit me. But then the pandemic happened, and the art show was online, but the show never really happened. And so since then, the last two shows, I've submitted two proof of concepts each time. And you never know what they're going to pick, you know. There's no names associated with the art when it's selected by Lucasfilms. It's just art. They just look, and they're all, I assume, numbered maybe, and they write down their favorites, and then that's how it gets selected.
Yeah. Palpatine one, is that the one that you showed me with that you had signed?
Yeah.
Yeah.
No.
It's on your wall. No?
Oh, it's on my wall. It's not signed by anything yet.
Oh, I thought so. I thought you got
you can kind of see it. There it is.
Yeah,
right
that
there.
One. Yeah. I thought you got that one signed.
No, it's not signed.
Oh, well, perhaps you could get it signed this year. Yeah. But, you know, getting back to your picture, as always, Jason, and I always say this, with your artwork, it always tells a story. And in the background, you can see the actual sort of like the impact, you know, when it comes and it hits the ground for the impact.
Yeah, well, I'm assuming there were multiple, you know, probe droids. Yeah, we saw the multiple ones shoot out of the Star Destroyer. And then, you know, I assumed, you know, well, also remember that there's an asteroid belt right outside the system, right? And so the general even said, the Rebel general, you know, with all the meteorite activity in this area, it's going to be hard to spot, you know, enemy ships. So, you know, that could be another probe droid. It could be just one of the many random meteorites that they encounter all the time. Yeah. But I felt it was a necessary addition to the print. It wasn't in the proof of concept. It was in the final art, though, that we see here. Because I just felt, you know, we saw it come through the atmosphere. We saw it crash land. And, you know, it's, you know, it was mentioned several times, like with the meteors and stuff. We never actually saw a snowspeeder spinning by one like we do here. But that doesn't mean it didn't happen. Right.
That's right. And do you know, when I watched the film, I always gathered that there was two that crashed, because if I think about if when this one crashes and you see it lift out, whoa, and it comes out, and then a bit later you see Han Solo riding, and then he looks and he sees one go, and I always thought that was after the fact that the first one had crashed, you know, it hit the planet, not that the second one was just the same thing, but from a different angle, if you know what I mean. So yeah, I always thought there was multiple ones that hit the ice, you could say. But you're dead right. It's one of them scenes, one of those iconic scenes. You know, the way is it Phil Tippett that filmed it? You know, where it comes out of the ground and in the noise, and then the arms go all in time as it floats off. Absolutely fantastic. And if I remember rightly, at the last celebrations, was it at the last celebrations? Somebody had actually built one. Somebody had actually built a full size one. Working. Yeah, yeah. They were I was like, wow. That is amazing. I mean,
it's not easy for them to move it around, but they did. They walked around celebration with it. It's on you know, like this fake ice pillar.
Yeah.
They dragged that thing around celebration last year. It was pretty funny. Yeah.
I was blown away with it. You know, when I saw it, I was like, wow, that was it. That's where I saw it. I saw it online. I was thinking, wow, that's amazing. Such amazing kit. But these droid builders, well, you being one of them, can do pretty good stuff. You know what I mean? Some pretty good stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, this print, I have to say, is gorgeous. Do you know, there's one thing I've always wanted to ask you about you, the way you do your style is, And I've often thought, you know, I'd like to have a quick go at doing minimalist and sort of thing. Is how many backgrounds do you count them? You know, for the back to the front, because it's like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You know what I mean? So, you know, if you was building it by card, and I always think, well, how many do you go? Because you know, even when you look at real life and you see buildings slowly going, and you think, how many is that? 1, 2. If I was going to build it, so you know, do you, as in a blank canvas, do you start with that big one at the back, or do you start one with the front, or do you just concentrate on like the droid first and then build up the back after the fact?
I actually, when it comes to the layers of the hills and the landscape, I actually start right in the middle.
Oh, dear.
I draw a line down the middle, give myself a horizon.
Mm-hmm.
And then I, you know, work backwards and forwards at the same time. My proof of concept, the background, the mountains in the background were flipped. So the hills actually came over the top of the droid. But I felt that was too, you know, it just didn't feel right. I felt like the mountains were working around the droid versus the droid being there. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I flipped those. That felt much better. Balanced out the background with the light on the left and the mountain on the right. The snow speeder in the background, I had it just as a speeder, just sitting there. I didn't have a little flare off the back or any motion given to it. The probe droid I used in the proof of concept was actually just a quick piece of clip art. I just, you know, that I had from other stuff I've done in the past when it was like really, really small on the background of another print. And I just threw it together. I did it as fast as I could really, on that final day.
Yeah.
But since it got, you know, selected, you know, I put, you know, 40 hours into this basic print, and I know a lot of people would say, why or how could you put 40 hours into something so simple? But
yeah,
you know, you try a million different ways, you know what I mean? You redraw the hills over and over again. I did the lens flares 100 different times before I was happy with what I settled on. Even the border on the print, I must have gone back and forth on the size of the border, like, you know, 10 times.
Really? I always thought that's just like a standard that, you're just moving into the space. You know what I mean?
Yeah. But, you know, how thin or thick do you want to make it? You know, the print you're actually looking at right there, I think I gave it another eighth of an inch more than what we see there before when it got on the press. I actually have a print. I just picked them up yesterday.
Ah.
So here we are.
Well, let me.
This is the actual print.
Oh, man.
And
that looks amazing.
A little bit of flare of light coming from
my
window. But
oh, do you know what that looks? I don't know why, but that looks better in your hands than it does seeing it actually on the screen. Do you know what I mean? It's come out really well, unless it's my monitor, my monitor on this side. But I think the actual print is fantastic.
We even got a little pilot in there. So
I don't know how do you do it? What's the resolution? Do you work with them? Do you know when you work on them? What's the resolution that you send them on?
Well, the Photoshop resolution I always work at is 300 to 365 DPI. But everything is created, every object is created in Illustrator. So they're all vector art that I create. And that way I can make it any size I want to without, you know, worry of losing quality. And once I bring in the Photoshop to do my layout and color and light, it's a minimum of 300 DPI. I usually do it everything twice the size it needs to be because I'm not sure on the final print size.
Yeah.
So I think I did close to around 18 by 24 to start with, and then I started scaling back as I started finalizing it. I decided not to go full bleed poster style print. I went with a more art print, you know, with the white border. And I just felt like this piece needed to be less poster, more art related. So
do you know, that's where I went with that. The way you've done this one, I think you've done them on just a couple of more, but what I like about them is, do you remember those old Ralph Macquarie pictures? You know, they're very much in the same style. You know, you've got your picture in the middle, nice border, but like telling you what's going on at the bottom of it. You know, it's a beautiful piece. I'm always amazed whenever you do silhouettes of stuff. I think you've got them perfect. I mean, you know, you always get, because on all your prints, when I look at them, you know, you can tell that's Chewbacca. You can tell that was Leia. You can tell that's art. You know what I mean?
If you can't tell what it is, trust me, I've done plenty of silhouettes where I've removed them because you just couldn't tell. You know, and difficult silhouettes, sometimes I will add an extra layer of visibility inside the silhouette. Like if you were to look at my Jawa's Palace piece, Max, the piano player, what's his name?
Max Rebo, yeah, there.
Max Rebo, thank you. Yes. So, you know, his trunk would have been hidden, you know, as a silhouette. So I added that. Or the Twirlian. I heard the squid guy to the left of C-3PO. You could see his tentacles on his chin area, too. So I will add an extra layer just to help. Resolve who it is.
But it's like, the guy that's standing next to Max Rebo. Well, I never remember his name, but you can make out that he's got big cheeks. Do you know what I mean? It's big cheeks.
And I had to add his nose in for effect too, because again, just the plain silhouette, it needed that extra little bit, little touch to it.
That's but, really good.
You know, I going back to the celebration piece, one of my favorite pieces I've done in the past is the T-47 Airspeeder, which is what's in the background there. But it was a print I did in, I don't know, 7 years ago with Acme Archives. It's on my site if you scroll down. And, you know, its main focus was the Airspeeder.
This one?
Keep going. There it is, right there. So again, we have another Hoth print, right?
Yeah.
But what's missing?
Pilots.
Well, sure, but the probe droid isn't there, right?
Oh, and of course, yeah.
I originally had him in there, but I felt like I had so many elements in this, it was too much.
Yeah.
And so I started to pull back and the probe droid didn't make the cut. That's always kind of stood out in the back of my mind, you know, that wasn't fair of me to cut him out like that.
Do you know, actually, when I was looking at your original print of the one for celebrations, do you know the shield generator? I was actually looking to see if you'd sneakily put the shield generators into it, funny enough.
I wanted to. I really did. Yeah. I thought about it many, many times, and I hemmed and hawed over it. But because it was so large in this print, I just kind of felt like that was almost too obvious. You know what I mean? I didn't want it to be so obvious of the probe droid that saw, you know, sent back the image to Vader of that thing. Yeah. I wanted it to, I just wanted it to be different than this print. Now, I say that, and then, you know, the biggest thing in this print is the snow speeder, and yet that's still in my new print, right? But this one's parked.
Yeah.
The new one is speeding along, so, you know.
Yeah, it's like you could say that that one is a prequel to this one. You could say is
right.
Yeah.
Right. Now, if I hadn't done this Hoth print, if I had not done that print there, I probably would have loved to put Luke on a Tauntaun in the background instead of the Snowspeeder.
But
I had already done it. So.
I suppose. There's many different variations you could do of this scene when you think about it, isn't it? You could put Luke, you could put.
I actually had a Wampa in this scene. Originally,
Wampa. Was he on his?
He was in the background, and he was, you know, you could tell it was him, and I had him in there. But I showed it to a few other artists and stuff, and they were like, "Yeah, lose the Wampa," and I was like, "Yeah, okay, you're right."
You know, that's. I suppose it's like, you know, what do you put in, what do you take out? And it's like, I really kind of like, looks good with that. I've done it myself when I've been doing covers for my podcast. Yeah, I've put so much on them, gone, oh no, I'll take that out. Then, but I always save it as like, say like 91A, do you know what I mean? Or 91B, you know, so I can refer to it. Just in case I want that little thing for another file, I know where to go to it. But it's a great piece. Absolutely fantastic. How does... So is there like an order form for this on your website? Or
be a link there. Friday morning, I will be adding a link to the site that will go directly to the pre-sale site at darkinkart.com, which is a company of Acme Archives.
Yeah,
and that's where all the pre-order sales will go through. There'll be 200 available for pre-sale.
Yeah,
and there'll be 50 reserved at the show that cannot be sold for pre-sale. So if you miss out on a pre-sale, just know that you're guaranteed there's going to be at least 50 more of them still at the show. Mm-hmm. I don't suspect it will sell out in the pre-sales. I've only sold out one pre-sale once and out of six celebrations. Yeah. And that was Chicago with the Cantina. It blew my mind that it was that popular, and I was, you know, I was taken back by that, but, you know, one can hope that everyone loves a probe droid.
Everyone loves a probe droid, yeah. Yeah, well, I can understand with your canteen one, because it's one of those pieces that you could get you could take it and get little signatures to all the people that were sort of, they're alive.
Lots of people did that, yes. Did it at that celebration, came back and showed me all the different people they had signed it. One guy even had a woman sign it, I forget her name, but she played the devil character.
Oh, yeah.
The horns, and that was a woman, and she was at Celebration Chicago and had signed that little piece. He brought it back and showed me. That was fantastic. I was working on a piece for Celebration as a cousin print to last year's print, which was the Death Star, and it was going to be of Bespin.
Done
in the same way with all the different levels, like they did with the Death Star. But I am nowhere near even close to you know, it's not even close to this. I mean, all I have done with it so far with the Bespin one is the size of the levels and then words telling me what's going to go in each level. That print there was, you know, that took me, it took me a year to complete it. It was like doing 10 prints in one. Every one of those levels has a lot of detail in it. And it just took me forever to get that one done. And 1 year from between celebrations, less than a year, 11 months between celebrations was not enough time. Well, technically, we had to have our submissions done by November, I think it was. So I literally had, you know, 6 months to five to six months to get my next celebration piece concept done. And so Bespin wasn't going to make it, but it's still on my mind. For
another time. Oh, and there's that that's that Dark Ink website there we was talking about.
Dark Ink.
Oh, it says it says it across the top. Star Wars Celebrations Europe 2023 attendee only pre-order for pickup begins Friday, March the 10th at 12 p.m. PT. What's that? PT
Pacific Standard Time, West Coast.
Ah, right.
Gotcha. Time. My time zone time.
Yours. Oh, so that's
Los Angeles time.
Right. So if so, people in the UK, that would be 6 o'clock, 6 p.m. Because we're 5 hours difference, aren't we?
It differentiates because of the
daylight saving time.
Daylight savings, which is also coming up, but yeah, I think it's around 6 or 7. What time is it right there right now?
It is 10:30. So
so that's 8 hours difference right there.
Yeah,
it's
yeah,
only 2:30 right. Here. So
yeah,
so 8 p.m. your time in the UK.
Yeah, is when 8 p.m. on the Friday, March 10th, you'll be able to get your pre-orders. So definitely get them in. It'll be worth it. Do we know roughly what's the price? Are you allowed to say
what the price is? Yeah, I am. And actually this year, because it's in the UK, things are going to be slightly different with the purchasing price. So if you pre-order, the pre-order price will be $50 US. Which roughly translates into, I don't know, between $40 and $43 or something like that. UK pounds.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But at the show, it'll be £60.
Oh,
because sadly it's because of the VAT that has to be included at the show. Anything sold in the UK, they're going to take 20% away from me right off the top.
Oh man!
And so they told us to plan for that. And then, you know, of course, Lucasfilm's royalty is another 20%. So I'm already 40% losing before the show even begins, right?
Oh,
so,
man.
So it's £60 at the show. $50 US on pre-sale. So if you're thinking about getting it, I would recommend pre-ordering it because you're going to save yourself almost 20 pounds.
Yeah.
By doing that.
Yeah.
And you know, maybe you can afford a print from another artist as well if you do it that way. So
yeah, very much so.
But I know quite a few other artists are doing the same thing. So
yeah. Are they? All right, that's good. You know, us British, we like to have a bargain. That's for sure. Yeah, always look for bargains, especially after the amount of money that being taken off us to go to Star Wars celebrations. That's for sure. I think me and my Chris that are going, I think that's all we talk about when it comes to celebrations is how much are you saving up? Oh, you know what I mean? Oh, well, I've got so much. I'm like, yeah, same.
How much are you saving, or which credit card am I going to use?
Oh, one of the two. I tell you what, I had like a tax rebate that's been put aside. Then I'm doing overtime. I'm like, let's take like 100 quid out of that. Let's take 100. But then it's like, oh, well, I've got to, you know, yeah, I've got to fix my car. Oh, then I've took money back. And so from when I first started, I think I started, hate to say it, right, with about £1,500 to take with me. Then the room, the rooms, and then the tickets and everything, and then food. And I'm like, oh, crap. So then it dwindled down to £400. And I'm like, So it's like, you know, I've put stuff on sale. I've put stuff to right. sell on vintage just to sell some bits. You know, I mean, trying to get some money together. But it'll be worth it, you know. Bless my Chris. He's booked for a couple of autographs, and he keeps saying to me, he goes, "What autographs are you paying for, Daddy?" And I'm like, "None. I can't afford it."
I know. I wanted to get like 5 or 6 of them myself, but yeah
for the price. No. Yeah. To be fair, you know, if I, you know, it's one autograph or one photo. Well, you know, if you like your artwork. One photo, you could get 4 pieces of artwork signed by the artist, couldn't you? And that's going to be permanently on your walls. A photo would be like, "Oh, look, this is me, you know, standing with a bit of plexiglass in the middle. Yeah, that's me. Yeah, that's it."
You know what I mean? You know, 2015 Anaheim celebration. That was my first one. I got tons of autographs at that one, and I believe I paid no more than $100 or $120. So that was for like Mark Hamill.
Wow. Gary
Fisher. I think on the low end, like John Ratzenberger, you know, Cliff from Cheers. he was in Empire Strikes Back.
Yeah, he was, yeah.
I think he was like $40. You know, I mean, it was like, I got like a dozen autographs at that show.
Yeah.
It was fantastic. Fantastic. Yeah.
Plus, you also had people coming, you know, coming by your desk, didn't you? And you were going, like Gareth Edwards.
Occasionally.
Oh, do you mind just signing this book?
Gareth Edwards in London, yes. Last London show, Gareth Edwards came walking by.
Yeah.
And I stole his autograph from him. Dave Filoni usually stops by the art show before the show opens up. And I've got, he's done a drawing in one of my my autograph book that I do all my Star Wars autographs in, which is so awesome to have.
Are you bringing that book?
Of course. Yes. Yes. I'm hoping, praying and hoping I'm going to get one autograph without leaving my table. Without leaving the art show area.
Yeah.
I'm hoping one celebrity is going to make their way in there.
Yeah, I hope so too. And,
and make me happy. So if any of them are listening, please stop by the art show. Stop by even before the show opens when there's no one else there. That's the safest time to come.
Yes, it is. Yeah.
And I will be there. I'm always the first to go and the last to leave, just to be sure. And that'll be fun.
Last time I went to Celebration, when last time it was in England, I remember looking at Carrie Fisher's and thinking, shall I buy Carrie Fisher's autograph? And I thought, nah, I'll get it another time.
Sure. Yeah, sadly.
Sadly. In fact, I took a photo of her, and some, you know how they have these volunteers, they grabbed my camera. Yes. Right.
Oh, and, the handlers. Yeah, they're very brutal.
Yeah, and I said, take your hand off my camera. And she was like, no, I'm sorry, you can't take any photos. And I says, listen, if you don't take your hand off my camera right now, me and you are gonna have a really serious problem. And she went, oh, right. Then I looked, and I had 3 blurred and one. I was like,
damn. I also have a picture of Carrie Fisher looking through my art. It was at a Comic-Con here in Portland that she came to, and she was looking to buy a piece of my art. And as she was looking through them, my brother was standing behind me, and you could see my shoulder and part of my beard, and he was all click. Yeah. And behind Carrie Fisher, you could see her handler going with her hand out, and she's all, no, she's like this. It's a great photo. I love that photo.
Yeah, but why? You know what I mean? Why are they like that? I just can't understand it, because it's us people that keeps them in business. You know what I mean? If it wasn't for us,
they want you to pay and get in line to do that. You know,
that's true,
what are you gonna do? But you know, hey, I mean, it's, you know, it's just a photo, people. Get over it, you know?
Yeah,
I mean...
Exactly, yeah. Exactly.
They're used to it, trust me.
Yeah, of course they are. Jason, are you only bringing that your print? Are you bringing anything else that people can pick up.
I will be bringing every print I still have available that's in my hands. So I have about 5 Jabba Palace prints still available. I still have 1 Cantina print available that I've held on to for this long. A few others. I will be bringing around 20 of the Death Star Celebration print from last year. We're not allowed to sell Celebration prints anymore outside Celebration. They've banned us from doing that. So, which, you know, they're just finding another way to screw the artist. But, you know, again,
if we don't chop the celebration bit off,
if we don't sell a lot of prints, you know, we could easily go into debt in the show so quickly. But they didn't say which celebration I have to bring it to.
So
I'm bringing, if I have one of those prints and I can only sell it at Celebration through Acme, I will be bringing every one of those I still have left.
Good.
So I didn't sell out at last year's Celebration for 2 reasons. One, some people are turned off by a 3-foot tall print. I get it. You know what I mean? There's not a lot of places you could put this print. And 2, it was $100, which was the most expensive print I've sold at a show before. But, you know, like I said, the amount of time I put into that particular piece, you know, $100 was pretty cheap as far as it goes. That's basically a, you know, a buck an hour I made making that print.
if you count,
you know, that for that one print. No other prints I could think of offhand. I mean, the ones are sold out are just, they're just sold out. You know, there's no bringing them back. But I should have a pretty decent amount of other prints for people to check out. I have my full portfolio there. I have this really great, nice book of my portfolio, and people can swing through it. They'll be marked if they're available or not.
Can you sort of like put like an order book down? So if people look at the portfolio, they could go, can I order that one here? And you go, yeah, just... You know what I mean? Have like a little iPad that links to you to Dark Ink or to your website that you can go, yeah, if you want that,
If there is a print that you want to buy and you don't want to drag it around with you at the show or fly back home with it, I will always give anyone the opportunity for, I will ship it for you. Unfortunately, for the Celebration print, you have to pick it up at the show, no matter what. But by coming to the show and picking it up, you have now satisfied Lucasfilm's agenda, and you can hand it back to me, and I will roll it up and ship it for you when I get back home.
Well, also it's Return of the Jedi's 40th anniversary. I do notice there is a lot of actors that were, you know, they did the bit parts, you could say, in Star Wars, in Return of the Jedi. So, you know, if you've got one of your, like Jabba's Palace, if you've got that, it's a perfectly good opportunity to probably get some signs for that at Star Wars Celebrations. Bearing in mind, they're all sold out. All the people that were, funny enough, given their autographs for free, or the photo for the photo options, you know, for free, they're sold out more than anybody else. Well, that's the look of the draw, I suppose. And also, there's going to be like an after show called Cantina 2 that's being like put on by Fantatrax. And there's going to be some actors from Empire Strikes Back and Return of the Jedi in that, go into that night to get some, so you could get some more signatures. In fact, if Jason had his, if you brought your previous print that we were talking about with, you know, with the snow speeder and the ATAT in the background, what's his name, who was in Indiana Jones and in Empire Strikes Back, Julian Glover. Yeah.
Yes.
He is. Yes. He's going to that. He's going to that party to do some sign-ins. So
that's fantastic. I'm actually getting his autograph and Wedge. God,
Dennis
I am
Lawson.
The worst with names. Yes, thank you. Ewan McGregor's uncle.
Yes.
They will both be here in June, just 2 hours from me at another Comic-Con.
Right.
And I was asked by that Comic-Con to do a print for their VIPs to sign for people who are doing signings for who are paying for both of them to get signed. And and my payment for doing that for them is I get a free autograph from each one of them.
Nice.
So
nice.
Yeah, so I'm stoked about that. So yeah, I'm really happy.
That's sweet. That's good.
My son's coming with me this year.
Yes, he is. Yeah.
Which I'm really excited about. His first time out of the country. You know, he'll be 14 soon. And it's just going to be a really, really great experience for him. You know,
I'm
super excited.
Yeah. Coming your first time in the UK and you're going straight to the big city into a Star Wars celebrations. You know what I mean? It's going to be great. My son also is going, Nicholas, of course, and your son and my son have been friends for many years, but they've never met. You know what I mean? I just see in a couple of years time, Jason, me shipping my son off to you for a couple of months.
Hey, my daughter just moved out again. So we got a spare room. You could ship him out over anytime. You want.
Yeah. If you spot any Bigfoots, let me know. You're like a good Bigfoot. So, that's about it, Jason, I reckon. We've done about 40 minutes. It's been absolutely fantastic talking to you again. And, you know, we all will always have you back on and to talk more Star Wars. So, Jason, where can the listeners and the people who are watching on YouTube get in contact with you, check out your artwork, order from you.
Sure. So my website is jasonwchristman.com, like it shows there on the screen. There will be a link to Dark Ink Art directly to the pre-orders, or you could go directly to darkinkart.com. And then you can see everyone's artwork. Lot of great art this year. One of my favorite artists who manages to get it every year and is also a UK artist is Malcolm Tween. And his piece of a U-Wing is beautiful. he did the Royal Stamp Collection, so I'm sure a lot of UK people know his work, maybe not him specifically.
Right. Let's have a quick look.
Oh, Eric Maul. Yes. Oh, God, yeah. I love Eric. Eric and his, you know.
Which one's that?
That's right there.
Amadeus.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Amadeus. Well, Eric did a book on this pose. What do you call it?
It's like the Mona Lisa pose.
Mona Lisa pose. Exactly. He has an entire dedicated to, you know, the art of Mona Lisa and how everyone has, you know, how it's affected art in life since then. And so he has done many, many pieces with this pose and they're just gorgeous. I love them.
It is a beautiful piece. Actually, Jason, do you want to spend 10 minutes going over these? Do you mind?
Yeah, let's look at them. Let's do that.
Right. Let's do. So let's have a look at what other artwork is on there.
Sure.
A bit of a nosy, shall we? Right. So there's one thing you're gonna know by going through this is there's a lot of Ahsoka, a lot. So right. So we got this piece is very good. I like this because it's sure I've seen something similar before where
that is Al, and last year he did an Ahsoka piece where she a little girl was standing in front of a mirror. And Ahsoka was in the mirror, and it was it's such a emotional piece, really. And this year he knocked it out of the park again with the dog and the kid. It's fantastic.
Yeah, and who hasn't done that kind of thing? You know what I mean? Who hasn't posed in front of a mirror with a broom handle?
I still do it.
Yeah. Do you know, I actually painted with emulsion, no gloss, blue paint on a mop, and so I could just whip it around. And like an idiot, because I was only like 8, I left it against it, and my mum come in, grabbed it, and it was like, why is this stuck to my hand? And I was like, oh, sorry, mum. But we've all done it. But I love that one. That one gives you that sense of, you know, this is me, and that's who I picture myself. You know what I mean? I've done it myself. Yeah. Done it myself, 100%. It's a beautiful piece. Absolutely beautiful. Protectors. I love that. But it says, when I first saw Star Wars in 77, when I was 7 years old, same here. At the time, they were no toy lightsabers, so I crafted one out of wrapping paper tube. I tried to recapture the sense of childhood wonder when I created this image. Yeah, I think he's done that. It's a beautiful piece. So the next one is this one. What's this one called?
Yeah, The Dark Times.
Dark Times by Jonathan, what's that, Beistlin? B-E-I-S-T.
Yeah, I'm not familiar with him. I'm not sure if he's a brand new artist for Celebration or not. I'm not familiar with him. I'm horrible with names anyways, so yeah. Even if he has been in before, I probably didn't remember. But so I apologize for that. But he's got some probe droid action. Yeah,
probe droid action. Yeah, we'd like to see some representation. Probe droids. Yeah. Yeah, this one is more of Obi-Wan Kenobi, isn't it?
Of course.
I mean the TV series. I mean the TV series.
Yes, Obi-Wan Kenobi, without series. Obi-Wan, yes.
Without Obi-Wan,
My favorite thing about this print is its faded texture. Mm-hmm. I'm a big fan of texture and color, or lack of, and that's why I like this print right here.
It's okay. Okay. Gone off that. Well, I've gone off that.
You won't hear a single bad thing out of my mouth when it comes to any of these prints.
All right. it's one that I particularly, you know, well, I'm the paying customer, you could say. I like it, but it's not one that I would go for, let's say, but I do like it. I'm like you. I like that texture kind of thing. And I often try and do that in some of my artwork, you know, with the like rough edges, or like been over time. You know what I mean?
Right.
How it's been timed. Yeah. So, but I like the colors on it. The only thing that sort of bothers me is the lightsabers are all the same color, and there's like no glowy on them. I don't know. Mm-hmm. Just think about that. But I like it. It's okay. It's okay. Let's move down. Now, this piece I do like. This piece I do like.
Yeah, Trisha Benson, My Only Hope. Yeah. No, it's gorgeous. It's gorgeous. You know, you got young Leia and older Leia. You know, that's her talking to him as a child, and then she probably never sees him again until she sends a letter inside R2 to him, right? So, as far as we know, they never saw each other again between these two.
And it's such an iconic pose, really, isn't it? I like it.
I've worked on a minimalist piece. I've worked on a minimalist piece of her and R2. But I was never happy with it, so it never seen the light of day.
Ah, right. Yeah, but I do like it. Yeah, I do like it.
I love it. Yeah.
Yeah, this one, Christopher was talking about this one because my Chris sort of grew up with Rebels, with Rebels as he was getting older. And so he likes his Rebels, and he likes this piece. Now, this piece looks like it's just been taken straight off the page, you know, off the TV series. To me, it's, you know, the artwork is bang on as like an image from the TV show. And you got the space whales featured in the new episode of The Mandalorian, Space Whales.
That's right. That's right. Love this piece. Mm. No, I love it.
And it's called
I love anything connected. Rebels. Rebels is one of my faves, for sure.
Yeah, it was good. You know what I mean? When I first watched it, I was thinking, is this for me? But as you watched it, I was thinking, no, this is really good. It's really
good. We're re-watching it before Ahsoka comes out, just so we can catch up on the Ahsoka connection and the Ezra connection. Because I think we all know Ezra is probably making an appearance in the Ahsoka TV show.
And Thorn, they're bound to bring it back. Because I've always had an issue about that last episode with Ezra and Thorn with the space whale. If you've not seen it, I'm going to spoil it here. The tentacles of the space whales come into the cockpit, smash through the glass, and then sort of go around, and then they warp out. And I was thinking, aren't they going to get crushed? without Windus? That was my only my thing, but that's a great piece. I love it. We are all connected. I like this one.
Chrissy. She is one of my favorite artists ever. She is so talented. Let me tell you, this entire piece is vector art.
Is it?
Yes. And she is so good at what she does. Some of her stuff has been on the Disney Plus channel. You know, the big giant banner when I'm Disney Plus. You go to the channel. A lot of her art is up there.
Wow.
At least I've noticed once they've actually had her name on a piece up there. And this is, similar in style and design to her Celebration Chicago piece, which was Darth Maul. So if anyone got that, they're bound to want to get this one to go with it. And it's beautiful. The detail for vector art that she does it's fantastic. I haven't figured out yet what it says around the triangle, but when I find time, I'm going to try and figure that out.
Is that actual lettering then?
I'm sure it is. I'm sure what she did was purposeful. So I'm going to try and figure it out on my own. And see if I can. If anyone figures it out before me, let me know.
I love how she's put that little logo there. You know, the Ahsoka logo right there.
Yeah, that's the symbol on her forehead for the most part. It's fantastic. Love it.
I think now my Chris's fiance Holly, she loves Ahsoka, and if she was going to buy a bit of artwork, I think this is the one she'd probably buy, to tell the truth. It is a beautiful piece, an absolute beautiful piece.
I think we're guaranteed to see an Ahsoka trailer at the show, so I think that's one reason why Lucasfilm selected so many Ahsoka pieces.
Yeah, I think so too. Unfortunately, if you don't get in on that panel, you're not going to see it, even though all the panels are streamed to the main halls. Whenever they show trailers, it cuts out, so you don't see it. But everyone will be straight on Reddit quickly before Lucasfilm take it down. Yeah, so that's a good piece. I love that piece myself. It's a beautiful piece. And of course, who's this one? Oh, Jason W. Christman's. Oh,
that one's okay.
Yeah, this one's all right.
Anyone's, it would be this one. I mean, look how easy it would have taken 10 minutes to do that one.
Do you know, funny enough, I know my wife Nikki, she often goes, she makes cakes, and she often goes to showcase at Cake Show International. And one of her friends done this beautiful wedding cake, absolutely beautiful wedding cake. And then she submitted this other thing called sandcastle. And she literally said, oh, this sandcastle one, because we were talking to her when she put it down, she goes, I literally made it in an hour. I just had some ingredients. I just slung it together. I thought I'll bring it, put it in. That one won bronze. And the one that she spent weeks making didn't pass, didn't get it. Yeah. It only got a merit. It was like, so it just goes to show you sometimes.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Know. Yeah, but I made one for that Cake International as well. I spent hours and hours and hours and hours on it, and I'll show you. I'll send you a picture, Jason. And then when I submitted it, right? You get these professional cake makers, you know, so that were looking around it like this, and they spotted one little wire, and it was nil and void. They said they can't judge it. I was like, oh, gutted. I'm like, what? It was my first time trying, and I was just gutted. I was just gutted about it. But there we go. You live and learn.
One more thing on this print. If blue is not your favorite color, you might want to stay away from this print. But otherwise, it's okay.
Yeah, I quite like it. I think it's kind of eye-catching. Yeah. I know that guy. He's pretty cool. Yeah. So this one, Guardians of the New Republic. I like this one. This sort of one that you would see on a banner in the street advertising what's coming on Disney Plus. You know, like what you said about that lady. This one's by Jason Davis, but it looks just like something that would be on Disney Plus. You know, on that banner that comes across. You know,
it's a nice collage. Star Wars is, you know, huge on collages, you know, and Star Wars loves its collages. And I think Jason Davies might be a UK artist, if I'm not mistaken. So, you know, if you're looking to come support local artists, this, I think, would be one of them to do that for.
Yeah. It's I like it. It reminds me of an older poster, like, when they re-release Star Wars Empire and Jedi and they put the whole sort of posters together. It reminds me of that. Yeah, it reminds me of that. It's pretty good. This one I like. I like this one, you know, with the shards of glass and Captain Rex and Ahsoka. Unbreakable Bond by Chris D.
Yeah, Chris D, another fantastic artist. He's been in and out of different celebrations over the years. I believe he's done mostly prequel type art, Clone War art. I've loved everything he's ever done. This year, he really blew me away. I mean, the... you know, all the images inside this fractured glass or crystal or whatever in the background is I just keep looking at it, thinking am I missing anything, you know? And I'm sure there's a story behind each one of these images in here and why he put them in here, you know? So I think this would be a good print to not only pick up, but, you know, to discuss with him, you know, and get some of those answers from him.
Yeah. I love that bit just there. If you can, I'm just scrolling around it where you can see Ahsoka with the clone helmets.
Oh yeah. Helmets. Yeah. See, yeah. I mean, you know, there's just so many little Easter eggs in this thing.
I like it.
It's great. There she is with Rex at the very top.
Yeah.
As well. Old Rex. Helmet off.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I do like that piece. I do like that one. He's actually put out, he said, the unbreakable bond between Ahsoka and Rex, we have witnessed it being forged over the course of several years and grow into one of Star Wars' most powerful friendships. Yep, I agree. It's absolutely totally. Fantastic. Now, this is like, this one is like, what's it called? Robot Chicken.
Yeah,
it's like a robot chicken. This one, advert.
Robot chicken. I mean, you know, it's you know, it's photographing toys, which is you know, another genre of art that people can do. We've had plenty of these in past celebrations as well from renowned toy photographer Stephen Hayward, and his pieces are super detailed because he hand makes every little detail to go around these action figures. not a lot of detail in this one, but the lighting's great. And, it is Return of the Jedi's. Maybe that's why my Return of the Jedi piece didn't get in, because this one did, you know, because I also had the Emperor in front of a window, right?
Yeah. So, right. But it's pretty cool because you know that the two lightsabers are photoshopped in, but he's put the glow in, if you look. You know, with lighting, with actual physical light, he's put the glow in on the floor. Which
you can see the extra effort he did to make sure that he had the right lighting and stuff. Plus, who doesn't love playing with toys still? You know, I'm 50 something years old and I still play with my toys.
Tell me about it.
They're usually sitting on a shelf, but hey, I pick them up sometimes and pretend I'm Elliot and E.T. and
Yeah, I like to sit here and tell me every now and again that I'm Batman with that one. I'm Batman. Yeah, so I like that piece. It takes me back to my younger piece. I'd like to see a follow-up of this one, but with the original Palitoy collection, with the straight arms. You know what I mean? The vintage collection, the retro. I'd like to see a follow-up with that one.
I think this print would have been much better if it had the cutout mouths on top of the faces, like Robot Chicken.
Yeah, do it, Lord Vader. Do it.
Stormtrooper.
Stormtrooper. Yeah, I like that one. That's great. Stormtrooper. Blah, blah, blah. None of this blah, blah, blah. Yeah, I like that one. And of course, we've got this fantastic one by Sam Gilby.
Star Wars loves its collages, and we got all the main characters here.
I must admit, I'm pretty collaged out with this kind of thing, because all the Marvel films do it, it's literally, they must have, whoever does these movie posters must have a template that they just insert hero with the big one, and they just go down the line of all the sub characters, and then they just whack it out. When it comes to movie posters nowadays, sometimes I just think that they just give it not to an actual artist to do, but just to one of the departments. You know what I mean? I'll do whackers of a picture, because I do love real good posters for cinema, especially the older ones. If you remember, there was a horror film back in the day called House, and the artwork was a finger pressing the doorbell, and I loved that image of a disembodied zombie hand pressing the bell. Loved it.
I know exactly the thing you're talking about. Yeah, I agree.
Yeah. But this kind of
I think Andor is probably the best Star Wars standout that's ever come, to tell you the truth. I mean, because you did not have to be a fan of Star Wars to have enjoyed Andor. It's relatable on so many different levels, being that, it's basically your basic rebels against oppression kind of story. Right. Yeah. And the fact that it's in a Star Wars universe is just bonus for us. But it was such a dramatic series. It's really, for me, it's one of my favorite Star Wars things ever.
Like we've chatted about it before, I had mixed feelings with it. Half of me thinks this is the greatest bit of Star Wars I've seen in a long time. And the other half of me thinks, God damn, this is quite boring. Do you know what I mean? But when I've gone back to it a couple of times and I've watched a couple of bits, and some of the scenes are brilliantly done.
I know.
You
know what I mean? I was afraid my son was going to find it boring. And we watched it together every Wednesday morning and before school. And you know, on one of this very, very slow episodes, you know, there was a couple of them, but, and, you know, I enjoyed it very much. And I remember at the end of the episode, I look over at him just to see the expression on his face or if he was asleep. And he looked over at me and he go, "Oh, that was the best episode yet." And I was like, wow, he really paid attention to it, you know? And, and I loved it for it. This print though, my favorite thing about this print is the top and the bottom. I love how the room blends in with the two bottom characters.
Oh yeah.
At the base there.
Yes. Yeah.
I love how the top shows that spectacle that they had on the planet, you know, in the sky.
Wasn't it called the Eye?
God, I can't remember what the name was, but you know, remember it was that rainbow,
fantastic
moment. You know what I mean?
It was absolutely brilliant.
It was so gorgeous. It was very beautiful. I'm actually thinking about doing a piece based on that as well.
Yeah, and that dam, that place, you know, they filmed that dam is up in Scotland. I've had a look at it on Google Maps. It is. I delivered a truck to Edinburgh, and I thought, I wonder how close it is. I looked and I was like, it's another 100 miles. I'll go back.
Another
100 miles there. It's another couple of hours there. But I know for you lot in America, another couple of hours, it's like, that's nothing. It's down the shop. But in England, it's like, no, I'm okay. But yeah, I do love this print. And, you know, like we were saying about Andor, the acting in it was superb. And you've got to think, because if I... Out of all the Disney era Star Wars films, and Rogue One is one that I always go back to. I think that's...
Yeah, me too.
That is, apart from, you know, The Mandalorian, Rogue One is the only one that Disney have put out that's felt Star Wars. You know what I mean? The rest is just like, cash in. But, you know, there was serious thought behind Rogue One, which I love. And this picture is it's brilliant. I love it. I do like it.
Yeah, and that's Sam Gilby. I don't think I've met Sam yet. This might be his first celebration, or maybe he's done one in the past before I came in.
Yeah. Do you know the only person that's missing from here is, do you know the lady that works for Skarsgård? You know, I can't think what his character name is in the show. She looked like Leia. She could have easily been cast as Carrie Fisher's replacement. I was convinced. She's just like her. Such a good one. You know what I mean? And a lot of people missed that this guy here that I'm circling. Anyone who's listening to this, I'm actually circling a picture of this guy that's just above Andy Serkis's character. Uh-huh. He was in Rogue One. He was in Rogue One.
Was he?
Yes, he was in Rogue One. Do you know when they go to blow up the base? Yeah. He's the one who's with, who has to go out and pull the switch, you know, to send the signal, you know, to reconnect. You know, when they had to reconnect that thing and he got shot, he got killed there. And then, of course, what's his name? The blind one. He then goes out.
Yeah.
Yeah. So a lot of people missed it, but I was like, sure, that's the guy on Rogue One. And it was, So he made it into the second one as well. So, yeah, it's a good piece. I do love it. And I like how you're pointing out, Jason, because I didn't notice it, how her coat in his coat, Andy Serkis's coat, actually blends into the boardroom below. Mm-hmm. That's genius. I love it. I love it. The next one we've got is another Ahsoka one, but this is Tales of the Jedi one. This is by Joe Hogan.
And let me tell you, Joe Hogan has been killing it this past year with Star Wars art. Last celebration, he did all the clone trooper helmets. There must have been 100 helmets on that page, all hand drawn in this style, all grouped kind of together. It was so well put together. It was by far my favorite piece of the whole show. He sold out so fast, and there's no reason why he shouldn't have. And this week, he has three new pieces announced. This one, and Dark Ink Art has two more pieces that were released yesterday.
All right.
Of his stuff. And those pieces are incredible as well. So highly recommend. If this is something you want to get, do the pre-order on this one, because this one's going to go quick, probably.
Yeah, yeah. And do you know what? I absolutely adored Tales of the Jedi. I thought it was brilliant.
Yeah,
and that story with Count Dooku really puts Count Dooku into another light for me. You know, I saw him. It's not the bad guy is he was made out. And in the end of the day, he was betrayed by his master. You know what I mean? He was just a pawn. You know what I mean?
Right.
So
right.
I enjoyed that. It's a beautiful piece. Yeah. Absolutely. You know, if you're a fan of Tales of the Jedi, that looks like it's been taken straight off the page, you know, off the TV. And if there's anybody there that's involved in it for signing, that'd be a great piece to get signed. You know, like voice actors.
Also, if you want a good laugh, stop by Joe's table. He is one of the funniest people. He's so funny. And this is a guy you want to come talk to, trust me.
Will do, will do. Now, this one is called, of course, Twilight on Endor. I do like this one. This is another one of those ones that looks like it's from a Ralph McQuarrie art book. I like it. I've always just loved the matte painting of Endor that was used in the final film, and this is great. I like this one.
Yeah, my favorite thing about this print is that it's a watercolor painting.
Yeah.
So, you know, much, much different than traditional acrylic oil painters or digital artists. So I like the medium that this one was designed in, and I think she did a brilliant job. I don't think I've met Sandra before either, so
yeah, this should be good. Do you know, it also reminds me of when I was a kid, you would often find these books that would come out with sort of like a late 70s early 80s style, if you know what I mean, Jason. And they were like, they were given away at school. You know, there was like I don't know if you had it in the States, but often you would have like a little catalog, only about 3 pages, but they would often have all kids' books in, and you would tick one, get your parents to sign saying this is the one. And then, of course, it'd be like £5. And then the very next week, they bring that book. And because I had one, which I managed to get back, actually. I had one called R2-D2 and C-3PO Explain the Solar System. So you got that sort of 70s look of the artwork of R2-D2 and C-3PO. But that gives me that it takes me back. It's sort of like there's a memory there that when I look at this one, I think, you know, that's a good memory of that style. I like it. I like that. And it also, I look at it and I can see it alive, if you know what I mean, you know, with the fireflies and the glow, and I can hear it. It's one of those ones that you can hear, you know what I mean? When you look at it, it's very good. Yes. Yeah, beautiful piece that is. And like you say, watercolor painting, just reading this, it's a traditional watercolor painting with a few digital touches. The inspiration for the Ewok village came from my beloved brother, who was a huge Star Wars fan and passionate collector of Star Wars action figures, aren't we all? Since his primary focus is on the Ewoks, these little creatures have a very special place in my heart since childhood. Oh, that's nice. That's very nice. I like that one. It's a good piece. Yeah.
Yeah.
Very good piece. this one, of course, this one's called We'll Handle This. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, and welcome back, Brandon. He's been in past celebrations. He's had lots of licensed pieces of Star Wars art. Incredible painter. This is all hand-painted. His wife is also a famous Star Wars artist.
Really?
She was in last year's show. Again, I'm horrible with names, but I'm pretty sure it's I think it's Katie Cook is her name. Let me see. Is it Katie? Well, Katie Cook is a Star Wars artist, but well, anyways, he's married into a whole Star Wars art family, and beautiful, beautiful piece. He's a great, great artist.
Wish
and
I could draw.
I really that. Love. I love his composition here with the backs of the Jedi. It's very well balanced. I just love it.
Yeah.
It's a great piece.
Yeah. It reminds me of the three action figures I've got. I got these large pieces, one of Obi-Wan, one of Darth Maul, and one of Qui-Gon Jinn. And you sort of, you put them together. Big figures they were. They're about this big. Very big. And they're all in those positions. You know what I mean? I like that one. I do like that one. And they've got, he's got managed to get that look of Darth Maul's face. Absolutely bang on. And you sort of know that's Big Liam, don't you? You could just see Big Liam in that. So it's fantastic. I do like that one. Do like that one a lot. Yeah. And of course, we've got Baby Grogu. Of course, we've got to have Baby Grogu in these pieces. And this one's done by Shyla Lee. Have I got that right? Shyla Lee?
I guess, again, another new artist, as far as I know.
Art Gru. 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 Gru.
Art Gugro.
Gugro. Grogu.
It's backwards, I guess. It's
backwards, yeah, of course, yeah.
Well, it's talking like Yoda, I guess, right? I don't know.
Yeah.
Would Yoda say Grogu backwards?
Probably. Probably. Again, beautiful piece. Beautiful piece there. It's got everything you can remember from it.
If you're a fan of Grogu, this is definitely the piece for you.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. It's got the frogs. It's got that spider things that he ate. His soup.
Yeah.
Macaroons. The macaroons. When he puked up the macaroons. And the bowl of soup that he got. Yeah. I do like it. I like that one a lot. And also, I do like the texture of it, you know, around the borders and that.
Yeah.
I like that one. Yeah. It reminds me of some other lady's work, though. Perhaps it's the same lady. I'm not too sure. But I do like, she's captured the look of Grogu perfect. Absolutely perfect on them. Even the frog looks really, really good. I think when I picked up the action figure, Jason, of Grogu, he's so small. You get like this little thing. And inside is like a little box. If I bring it closer to the camera, people on the podcast won't be able to see this, but if I bring it to the camera, you got like a little frog in it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Little frog in it. You've got a bowl and the top bit, you got a bowl. And then you've got that little nut, you know, that little ball that he plays with. But it's so small. It's so small. It's like of a proper action figure. You see, that's like so small. Yeah. Well, the action figure is really, really small. He's not that big. So I don't take it out because I know I'll just lose them. Just lose them. Yeah. So, yeah, I do like that piece. Again, another fantastic piece. Let's go down to the next one. Of course, we've spoken about this one. She looks gorgeous. She looks absolutely beautiful in that pose. And those eyes. She's captured the eyes.
Totally. Absolutely.
So he's captured the eyes. Perfect.
Eric, again, another incredible artist. So detailed, everything he does. He does a lot of top cards, sketches, you know, for the trading cards, tops. And even his little tiny cards that he hand sketches and paints himself have so much detail in them. It's amazing. And if you ever are lucky enough to open up a pack of Star Wars trading cards and find an Eric Maul sketch inside of it, you won the lottery, because you might have a better chance of winning the lottery than finding one, but someone out there has. And he posts them on his Instagram account all the time. So
It's a stunning piece. I do love that one. I love it. And then this one's interesting. I like this one as well. I've always been fascinated with these cutaways and stuff. Of course, that is Luke Skywalker's robotic hand. Hope, it's called. So it's like when
I love this print. I'm a huge fan of typography, for one. So, you know, I recognized the word hope instantly.
See it.
When I saw the print. And as light of detail this print may have, it's full of detail when you stand and look at it for a while. I mean, I love how the lightsaber hilt is taken apart, and we've got the Rebel logo almost as its crystal, you know, in the middle.
Yeah, of course.
The lines going around the outside of the whole thing is reminiscent of, you know, a droid port, you know, locking thing that it's turning into.
Yeah, also, that's Jason, do you know when they bring up a star map and the quadrants?
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. Star map too. Yeah. Yes. That whole part of the star map thing. Yeah. Mm. But it's a beautiful piece. I love the colors. I might actually be getting this one myself and hang it up in my office for a while.
Do you know, I looked at it a couple of times, and it's only when you said it that I suddenly saw hope down it. And that, yeah, I like it. Yeah. It's a beautiful piece. That is, there we go. Yeah, I do like that one myself.
Ashraf Omar.
Yeah.
I don't think I've ever met him either. Lots of new artists this year, which I love.
Yeah.
I'm just glad they kept me around.
Of course, this is based off the deleted scene in Return of the Jedi. One of my favorites from the original trilogy, Luke Skywalker building his lightsaber in the cool scene that we didn't see in the film, except for the deleted scene. This takes inspiration from it. And of course, didn't they show that at last celebrations? They sort of did colored it, you know, they redid it just as a proper deleted scene, you know, because it was kind of rough when it was first shown.
Yeah, it was still even in the DVD collection when they added it as a deleted scene, you could watch not in the movie but outside the movie. It was still really rough and washed out looking, but it's a great concept for a print.
Absolutely.
I'd be proud if I was him. That's a good one.
Do you know what I'd like to see? Maybe a print based on the sandstorm. Do you know when they're saying goodbye? Another deleted scene.
Yeah.
With the Falcon in. I'd like to see something like that. That's one scene I've always wanted to see.
He didn't make it in the art show this year, but Chris Trevis, in the past few celebrations, he's done two pieces inside the Millennium Falcon before they went and rescued Luke and after they rescued Luke. He has two different celebration pieces. And if you ever get a chance to look those up, they are incredible. One of them is them planning to do the rescue. They're on the hollow chest table and they're kind of planning it out. And then the other one is where, you know, she's in her Slave Leia outfit and everyone's, you know, just getting back to the ship, basically, you know, after they rescued Luke. And it's just so well thought out. Who thinks of that? You know what I mean? It's just so well thought out.
And that's
I love it when a plan comes together. You know what I mean? I like that.
Yeah. So. And I bet Han said, you can keep that outfit on. Keep that on. So this one, of course, now we go into some artwork for the Disney sequel trilogy, of course, Rey the Scavenger. This one is by Frank Samson.
Yep, another new person. This is kind of reminiscent of Karen Hillian.
Yeah,
actually,
that's
Karen
it.
Hillian. Karen is who is married to Brandon Kenny. That's who's married to Brandon Kenny.
Yeah.
He actually proposed to her on stage at Star Wars Celebration Chicago. I'll never forget it. Yeah, she got asked to come up and on stage and talk about her thing.
Yeah.
And he surprised her by in front of a million people.
Wow. taking a chance there, lad, just in case she says no.
So power, it's a Star Wars art power couple. They're fantastic. Yeah.
You're so right.
Frank Sansun.
Yeah, go. Go.
Well, getting back to Frank's print, you know, he's got that Karen style, which everyone loves because her stuff sells out very quickly. So he's he's going to be happy, I think, with his pre-sales. But it's a great piece. I just love the detail on the bordering of this whole print. I think it's great.
Yeah, it's got all the little bits, because you see here the old X-Wing helmet plus the little doll just there, and of course you've got the X-Wing there and the crashed Star Destroyer, and of course BB-8. Yeah, when I saw it, when you said it was is it Karen? What did you say her name was?
Yeah, Karen.
Because she does a lot of Disney princesses like this. And yeah, exactly. She's also done and I do follow her on I think it's on Instagram or it's on I think it's on Instagram. I follow her.
She will be at the show with her husband, so she'll be there too. And I mean, I'm not sure if she'll be selling anything, but I don't see why she couldn't. So she could have some stuff there too. So if you come by the show, definitely stop by Brandon's table.
Absolutely.
And Frank's, of course.
So we've got this one as well. This is one, the Ashes of Mandalore. This one, this one's pretty good, by Adam Shakalin.
Yeah, I'm not sure how to pronounce his last name either. I don't think this
looks like Shakalin.
First time.
Yeah,
his name sounds familiar to me. So he may have been in past celebrations, or I mean, everyone in the celebration show is already, or was already, a licensed artist with Lucasfilms in one shape or form or another. So, you know, it could be something as simple as a top sketch trading card, or maybe they've done, you know, a t-shirt. But whatever the case is, they've done artwork that was approved by Lucasfilms. Regardless of the road they got, how they got there. This is a great piece, though. I mean, Bo-Katan is a character that a lot of people love, and love her.
Yeah, absolutely.
And Katie Sackhoff is an incredible actress.
She is.
You know?
Yeah.
Starbuck. As other sci-fi fans know her as.
Yeah.
And
Battlestar Galactica, of course, I adore her, you know, because I remember when she was announced she was playing Starbuck, I was like, what? But it, for her, worked. 100% worked.
Guess what I just noticed? What's that on next to her neck there?
Is that? And just there on the opposite side?
Yeah.
Probe droids!
I have more probe droid competition here. So.
Yeah, more probe droid competition. Yeah. Of course, this is a scene. I take it. It's the, what's it called? The Night of a Thousand Tears, isn't it? Where Mandalore explodes, basically, with the TIE bombers going over. And the dark saber. It's a beautiful piece. I do like it.
Yeah.
It's captured. I love the texture. Yeah. It's a great piece. That is great piece. So let's nip. This one I do like. Academy BFFs by Nick Scurfield.
Mm-hmm.
I might be pronouncing this wrong, but I like this one as well. I think it's very cute, very Nickelodeon kind of thing.
I love child representation of certain of things, and so this is kind of right up my alley as far as liking stuff. It's just so cute. Who doesn't like cute stuff? And
it reminds me of like concept art for a Pixar movie.
I mean, I could see a short based off of this, what I'm looking at. Absolutely. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's got a lot of inspiration looking at it, and for something as simple as it is, you know, I love minimalist type work, and I love negative space, and he has used it quite well in this print. So,
Yeah, it's a beautiful piece, guys. It's absolutely fantastic. Yeah, I'll agree with you. I do like that one. This one's very interesting. This one looks really long. It's called Beyond the Jedi by Lin Zai.
Lin Zai. Yes, she's been in many celebrations in the past. She's done Ahsoka, I think, several times.
Mm-hmm.
And this is her latest version. I think all of her prints in the past have been about this exact same shape and size. So if anyone has bought her prints before, they will recognize, you know, this whole style. I love how light this one is. A lot of her stuff in the past has used a lot of heavy color and has been dark. This one's very, you know, faint and ethereal, and I love it. I love the colors and, you know, the subject matter. Again, another Ahsoka piece. Everyone loves those wolves.
Yeah, they do. Yeah,
but you know, you go with what you like, you know. And she's knocked it out with this one.
Do you know this one would look good done on like a slightly see-through canvas with a light trolling out the back of it. You know, a light pushing the colors out.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I like that one. You know, giving it that sort of like spectral.
I mean, she very well may have. I mean, this almost looks like a watercolor on canvas or on watercolor paper has a texture similar to this too. It's hard to take a watercolor painting, digitize it for printing, and not get the texture. You know, so if the texture we're seeing in here comes from the actual paper texture that it was originally painted on, kudos to her for keeping that in the print. It gives it that extra layer of authenticity to me that I love this print. I've always loved everything she's done in the past. I'm glad to see her back this year.
Yeah. It's absolutely a beautiful piece. I tell you, my Christopher's Holly, she's going to be spoiled for Ahsoka pieces. Absolutely, you're spoiled. I like this one as well. This one is good. I've always like scenes that look like concept art, Things That Were by Zoltan Simon.
Zoltan. I don't... A lot of us artists share our art with each other as we're, you know, finalizing for the show and stuff. You know, we give each other a little critique here and there. So, you know, some of us are friends online and stuff. And I don't remember seeing this until it was released. And I am blown away. I love this print so much. Zoltan is, I can't remember what country he's from, Eastern Europe somewhere. I don't remember the exact country. He's big, I think, where he is. You know, a lot of us haven't heard of him before, but he has been in, I think this might be his second or third celebration.
Yeah.
He does some pretty off-beaten designs in the past that have blown me away. Things that no one has ever thought of as far as art is concerned in the Star Wars world. This is kind of in line with more of a, why am I the worst with names? Jerry Vanderbilt, I can't remember his last name for the life of me. Him and his daughter have been in many celebrations. And this is kind of reminiscent, I think, of their style, framing of it's a beautiful piece. It's one of my favorites for sure. Definitely my top two of the show.
Yeah, of course.
I could look at this print. I could look at this print all day. This print would easily go up on my wall.
It's beautiful because that's Naboo It looks like Naboo to me. And you can you can just see the clouds moving and the water falling as she's as Ahsoka is walking. Now, this is that an engine or an escape pod? I'm not too sure. What do you reckon?
My guess is it is an engine or part of a ship. I guess we'd have to ask him when we get there.
Yeah, we'll have to. I'm definitely asking. But an absolute superb piece that is.
Yeah.
Things that were. Poster covers.
Plus the coolest name ever.
Yeah, Zoltan. Yeah, I wonder if he's got. Isn't there a Zoltan machine that gives out fortunes in big or wishes? Sure, it wasn't it. It'd be cool if he had one of those machines there as well.
That delivers Zoltar. The post.
Yeah. Zoltar, yeah, of course, yeah. My poster conveys that there has been lost. The Jedi's are gone. The Republic is gone. Padme is gone. But even if it is nighttime in Naboo and also the Age of Darkness for the galaxy, the soothing blue colors and the glowing moonlight promises there is still hope. Ahsoka mourns the things that that were, as we have seen in Tales of the Jedi. She just heads to the starfighter now, but eventually her way leads to bringing back light into the galaxy.
So there you go. It's a starfighter.
Printed using special 11 color pigment ink to ensure the rich expression of the subtle hues in the moonlight night. So that's amazing.
Awesome. I can't wait to see this one in person now that I've read that. That's pretty awesome.
Yeah, that is beautiful. Another bit that looks like concept art, Extraction Team Bravo. I love the Y-Wing. I don't know. I just love the Y-Wing. Is it a Y-Wing?
Mm-hmm. Yes,
isn't it?
Yeah. No.
U-Wing. It's the U-Wing. I love it. Yes. I've got one up here on my shelf. Oh, it's right back there. I just love the look of it. And this is beautiful. He's put, I love to try and show some of the scenes we don't necessarily get to see in the films. Bravo team with Sergeant Melcher and K2SO have landed on I can't pronounce Star Wars names all of a sudden. Wobiana and
Wobani.
Yeah, I'll go with that, Jason. And they're about to set out to rescue the high value rebel target Jen Erso. Yeah. I do like that bit. You know what I mean? I do love it. Do you know what? It looks like it's in the Batcave. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Malcolm is probably the closest artist today in the Star Wars world to a Ralph McQuarrie style and detail that we have in our generation. So... And, you know, we've discussed this many times in the past. You know, he's a UK artist. He did the Royal British Stamp Collection for Star Wars.
Oh, this is his. Yeah.
That's his, yep. I have every piece he's done since 2015. I have them all in one picture frame because he does the same size print every year.
All right.
So, and my print is the same size as his this year. And so I have one frame with all his prints in it. And then every so often I swap them out and put the new one in front. And
that makes sense. Yeah, that's a pretty good idea. That I do like that one, Jason. I do like that one a lot.
This one's going to go fast. So I highly recommend if people want this one, they pre-order this one for sure. Yeah. It's going to go.
Beautiful. That concept, it looks just like Ralph McQuarrie concept art.
Yeah.
And captured the look.
Oh, ironically, his piece last year was a probe droid. it was old Obi-Wan facing off with a probe droid.
All right.
It's fantastic. It's a fantastic print.
Yeah. Oh, I'll have to have a look at that one.
I forgot about that until after the fact. So just saying.
We'll have a look at that. In fact, I'll try and remember and we'll bring it up on the normal show, actually. And this one is another Ahsoka one. I didn't say who it was from. I can't even pronounce that name, Jason. Can you? Victory and Death by Cassine. Is it a silent K? Cena. Senna.
Is it? I don't know.
The last.
Cassina Valen. Valensova.
But yeah, we'll go with your pronunciation with that. yeah, we'll go with yours.
Let's go with Xenia. I don't know. I don't know. I can't wait to meet her to find out.
Yeah, get her to pronounce her name. Well, she says it. She had an inspiration for the piece since I first saw the Clone Wars season final, which left me with a lot of emotion. The idea of the piece came from the duality of the title, the very last episode, how the two concepts can be equally applied to each other. Yeah, so you got Order 66 and the what happened afterwards, you know what I mean, when she walked away with the with all it's, yeah, it's a beautiful piece. It reminds me of those old cards, you know, the deck of cards you used to get, the Star Wars cards,
and you would
have, like the Queen of
Hearts. It does have you got the regular playing cards. When when you're dealing with the face cards, it's the same. You know, you can flip it.
Yeah, beautiful.
I like this one. You could obviously probably hang it any whichever direction you wanted to.
Whoever you want
on top. You know.
Yeah, it would have been good if like you had Star Wars celebrations there, but you also had it here. Underneath, you know what I mean? So you could flip it.
That's true. Yes. Yeah.
Unless Lucasfilm said, no, you can only have one logo.
Back at Malcolm's, Malcolm always puts the Star Wars logo and the celebration logo on his. So you scroll up a little bit and you can see.
There. Yes, you're right.
Yeah. So he always adds both of them to his.
Do you know when you add it, do they say how big it should be or where to place it? They don't?
No.
Okay. All right. So it's a bit free. So
maybe
so
that's they should it. In some cases.
Yeah. So that's it. It says here at the bottom, for people who are listening to this this podcast, it says pre-orders will go live at darkingart.com on March the 10th at 2 p.m., which is 12. Didn't we?
No, it's 12 p.m. Pacific time, 8 p.m.
8 p.m., UK. That's it, 8 p.m. Yeah. UK time. Yeah, that's right.
And that will run for 10 days until March 20th.
Yeah. All prints will be limited to 250 pieces, with 200 available for pre-order and pick-up at the art show and 50 reserved for sale at celebrations. All pre-orders are picked up only. No pre-orders will be shipped. So as you say,
unless you come to the show, pick it up and hand it back to me, and then I'll
But I think a majority of them will be taken on with them, to tell the truth.
Hey, you know, if you plan on coming to the show and you pre-order my print and for whatever reason you can't make it, it happens to one person almost every year, you know what I mean? A death in the family, you got ill, who knows the reason you couldn't make it. You know, maybe your flight was delayed, or if you're coming from far away, and you didn't make it. I will make sure you get your print. That is, I don't want anyone to worry about that. You know what I mean? So, if you're coming to the show and you can't make it, you can go to my website and contact me and say, crap, I bought the print, I still want it, what can you do for me? Hint, hint.
Fantastic.
Just send it to me.
Cool. That's a Christman promise there, right there. Then, so you could check out StarWarsCelebrations.com for more information. Star Wars Celebrations Europe 2023 will be held April the 7th to the 10th, 2023, at the XL London in England. And I'll be there. Jason's going to be there. Definitely going to be there because he's got prints to sell.
I have one question for you. Do you think anyone's going to be there on Monday?
On the Monday? I think am I going to be there on Monday?
Monday.
It's done on Monday, isn't it?
Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and Monday.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm going to be there Monday.
Well, are you going to be there Monday?
Yeah.
Oh,
sure.
All right. Great.
Because originally, we how they did this at the ticket system was strange, Jason, because my wife was ready, and when we got straight onto the queue, and the 4-day tickets were sold out. They were sold out. So you had to buy individual day tickets so they would get you on the price. And you know what I mean? That's the one thing that I hated about it is that they've really fleeced the fans with the ticket sales. You know what I mean? How come you can buy 4 individual days, but you can't buy a 4-day pass? It doesn't make any sense. It doesn't make any sense at all, but it's the way things are. If you want to go to these things, you've got to pay the price. But like I've also said to Christopher, that is, like yourself, Jason, you've gone to smaller conventions and you've managed to pick up some of these autographs for $50, $60. The only reason these prices are so expensive here is because, A, it's a Star Wars convention, and they're going to try and cash in as more... I'll just see what's behind me. they're just cashing in, really, because they know everybody's there. You're going to get, you know, the amount of money that's going to be spent. Bearing in mind, we're in a recession in the UK. No one can afford, for some reason, their electric and gas, but by God, I'm going to get that autograph.
Well, I hope so.
Yeah, absolutely. Right then, Jason, it's an absolutely fantastic. I'm glad that we managed to go over the other prints. I'm really glad we managed to do that. Again, Jason, how can people get a hold of you?
Again, my website, jasonwchristman.com, or on Instagram, I am Star Wars Artist, no spaces.
Yeah.
Or you could Google, or you can, type in my whole name, Jason W. Christman. I'm sure you can find me that way as well. But Star Wars Artist on Instagram.
Yeah, cool. And I've just put it there on the screen again. Jason W. Christman, recognize that name and that logo. I love that, your logo. I stick it on everything. Whenever I've got you on the show, I always stick it on.
I did want to show you one thing before we leave.
Okay.
This is my business card holder. And I'm sure people have seen these before. But you click this, and your business cards come out the bottom, right? So for the show, I did my cards this year are foiled Han Solo frozen in carbonite.
Oh, Matt.
With all my information on the back, QR codes to get to all my places online. But yeah, I did a foil.
That is mad. I love it. I'll definitely get one of those, and it goes
inside. So you get your own Han Solo frozen in carbonite coming out of Han Solo's frozen carbonite car.
Yeah. So I love it.
So Where did you get that from? You've heard of ThinkGeek before, right? The old website that got bought out by GameStop and then it just disappeared forever. Yeah. They had them a long time ago and I bought one, and over the years I wore it out and a screw came out and then the springs got lost and I found this one on eBay. So, yeah. And they haven't made them in a long time, but it was for $50 on eBay and I hearted it, but I didn't buy it. Let me think about it. I heard it, and then the next day he offered it for like $29.99. I was like, sold. So I said, well, that's amazing. If you're gonna take $20 off, yeah, I'll 100% buy it. Yeah. Come by my table, you get one of those for free.
Oh, magic! I'll do that because I've still got some of your older ones. Your in my drawer there. I was trying to find it, but it's in there. Absolutely, Jason. Brilliant. Thanks for coming on the show. Thanks for showcasing your artwork. Yeah, beautiful piece. And remember, everybody, please, please show some love for these artists because they do spend a lot of time on this stuff. And the only way they can, bring it to you is by people buying it. So please go out and buy there and support your local artists. You know what I mean? And support Jason. Jason's coming a long way to Star Wars celebrations. I mean, just to buy a pint. Yeah. Long, long way.
Yeah. It's a very expensive pint, for sure.
Yeah, very expensive. Okay. Well, we'll see you later. And thanks, Jason, for coming on.
All right. Thanks, Jamie.
Brilliant.
Good to see you.